Okay, good morning everyone. Apologies, I can't actually see the audience. Maybe that's a good thing. Good morning and welcome to IDX. It's a real pleasure to be here in person this morning, to meet everyone. And I'm sure you'll agree, there's a real buzz around the conference this morning. My name is Bruce Savage, and I'm the head of FIA in Europe, and I'll be moderating the next panel on the landscape in the UK and the EU. I'm absolutely delighted to be joined by such an excellent group of speakers who will, for the next 50 minutes, share their views on the current regulatory landscape in the UK and the EU. We're going to talk about potential deviation of regulations and what that means with regard to euro clearing and equivalents. I have the pleasure of introducing, from my left, Dan Maguire, CEO, LCH Group. Nafisa Yusuf, Vice President, Market Structure at BlackRock. Bill Stenning, Head of UK Public Affairs at SocGen. Emma West, European Head of Futures and Options in OTC Clearing, Bank of America. Phil Simmons, Global Head of Fixed Income Sales at Eurex. And last but not least, Kirston Winters, Head of Legal Risk Compliance and Government and Regulatory Affairs. That was a bit of a mouthful to get my, my teeth around there at OSTTRA. So welcome everyone, and thanks for participating today. So we're gonna kick off with euro clearing and equivalence, and then we'll move on to discuss regulatory deviation. Just setting the scene slightly, you know, the European Commission has been encouraging EU banks and market participants to reduce excessive exposures to UK CCPs and has kicked off industry working groups with the industry over the last few months on opportunities and challenges to transfer clear derivatives from UK to EU CCPs. The Commission has made it clear on several occasions that the current status quo with regard to euro clearing is unacceptable. For financial stability reasons. And all this is happening with the backdrop of the clock ticking down on time-limited equivalence, as we've heard this morning already, at the end of June next year. So can we start off with Kirston to give us an independent data perspective of what's going on from a trading and a clearing perspective with regard to euro-denominated interest rate swaps? Kirston.
Thanks, Bruce, and thanks to the FIA for inviting me to speak today. It's great to be here in person. I'm going to use some data from the global OTC swap markets that we process, post-trade process through MarketServe, which is now part of OSTTRA. This processing takes the swaps from execution on trading venues through clearing, settlement, and reporting. So it really is a kind of unique view on the market that we have. If you want to bring the slides up. So if we start with trading location and the DTO and the lack of equivalence between the EU and the UK, since January 2021, we've published some data showing what's happened in the market for the three primary currencies, sterling, dollar, and euro. And in this session, we're going to focus on euros and the graph is on screen. As you can see, there's been a substantial shift. The EU venue share, which is in gray, has grown from about 5% in January 2020 up to about a quarter of the market share in the previous quarter in Q2 2021. Equivalently, the UK share, trading venue share, has fallen from just under 40% back in January 2020 to just under 10% today. Equally, the CEF share, US CEFs, which is in gold, has grown from less than 10% back in January to just under a quarter. This shift in market share, though, is only part of the story. What we also see is that there's reduced market access. So EU and UK banks and EU and UK clients have reduced market access. They cannot face people necessarily on venues they could use before or face counterparts that they could use before. And essentially, the EU venues have gone from the smallest to the largest in euros. The UK venues have done the reverse, and the CEFs have more than doubled, in fact, nearly trebled their market share in this time period. These shifts in trading location are not necessarily a surprise. The OTC derivatives markets are global in nature, And execution in particular has been very agile over the years. We've seen shifts in the past around certain regulatory changes. Overall, across euros that we see here, sterling and dollar, actually more of that UK trading venue activity has gone to the US, about 2.4 trillion in the month of March alone, and then to the EU, which was about 1.6 trillion in the pounds, that is, in the month of March alone. So that gives you a flavor of what's happened in trading. In terms of clearing, we've also conducted some analysis on what's happening there, and we've focused today again on euro swaps. There's currently time limited equivalence in place until the middle of June 2022. We haven't yet published this analysis, but we're going to share it with you today. Or we would if the clicker was working. There's a big green button that says next, so I'm, oh, there we go. There we go. So I think as with any data, it's really important what we sort of define what we're saying here. So this is cleared single currency euro swaps. This doesn't include FRAs. This accounts for about 95% of all euro swaps traded globally. It does include both fixed flow basis swaps, but does not include, as I said, FRAs. This represents clearing at around 11 CCPs globally that we connect to. It is a measure of trade count. It's not a measure of DVO1, and it's not a measure of the itinerary outstanding. It's a measure of what's happening, new trades in any given month. So with that said, let's kind of look at the data. So EU CCPs, which are in a lovely terracotta color, have grown from around 5 or 6% at the start of the period. Had a bit of a spike pre-Brexit with some transitional activity and have ended up just over 10%. So effectively the market, the EU cleared market for OTC swaps has doubled in the period. If we flip to the next slide, because the clicker doesn't work. We then took a look at aggregate notional. So as well as looking at trade count, what's happening in terms of the aggregate notional executed. And what you actually see is essentially the same graph. It's just the levels of the percentage market share are slightly different. So in this case, we saw that the terracotta line goes from about 3% up to about 7%. So again, more than doubling, but obviously a slightly lower base. So what we then did was we broke this down by the CCPs. Just checking because I can't actually see that. We broke this down by the CCPs that trades were cleared at and looked at where those trades came from. So for example, in EU CCPs, you can see that 60% of the trades, so the second column, the purple box, 60% of the trades originate from EU venues. Whereas for UK CCPs, less than 30% of the trades originate from EU venues. And for US CCPs, over 80% originate from the US venues. That's in the green at the end. So what you see is there is some correlation between trades that are cleared in a particular venue and where they originate from. On the next slide, we take the reverse look. So we look at what's traded on the different geographical venues, and we look at where they go to clearing. So in this case, we see that for Euro swaps traded on EU trading venues, over 70% of the trades are cleared at UK CCPs. Again, this is on a trade count basis. And for UK trading venues, which is the second column, we see that was over 80%. For US trading venues, it's over 95%. And for off facility, so basically traded bilaterally, not on any venue, it's again over 90% at UK CCPs. So that gives you a flavor of what's going on. I think one of the hypotheses that have been out there in the market is there's maybe a differential between short-dated and long-dated activity and where that clears. What this graph looks to show you is that the yellow columns is the percentage of total trades that that maturity bucket makes. So if you look at the 10-year, you can see that makes up 20% plus of all swaps done. And then you can see the market share overlaid in the terracotta and the green, which really shows you that actually in the liquid tenor points, it's actually pretty consistent. There is a small drop in the 30-year, where slightly less is cleared at EU venues than for the other key tenor points. So Bruce, hopefully that gives you the intro in terms of what the data is showing us, and look forward very much to the discussion.
Kirston, thanks very much, and that's a great overview, and I think it's great to put it into context for the, you know, the next 20 minutes of conversation. And I'd like to get, you know, the LCH and the Eurex view on, well, their view on data, and what they've seen with regard to any changes in outstanding liquidity. That would be the first question to both of you. I'll ask Dan first, but also to get your view on, you know, the Commission's view on the financial stability risk to the EU, and, you know, is there a financial stability risk, and what are the potential solutions? So, Dan, kicking off with you.
Okay, thanks, Bruce, and great to be here. Thanks for inviting us, and good to be amongst people. And I think, Kirston, you must win a prize for getting the word terracotta. So, well played. Clearly, you're betting the office that. Look, to answer your first question, we've seen very little change. And you can see from the statistics there, those are independent data, not Dan Maguire, CEO of LCH, saying that. So I think I'll leave that there. The data is the data, and it's good to just be looking at facts and data. To go to your second point, I think what the data is really showing us is that the Euro and the EU firms, both sell side and buy side, are part of a much bigger global ecosystem and liquidity pool. And they're benefiting from being part of that, and the system is benefiting by them being part of it as well. I think what's interesting, this is very Euro-focused, what Kirston has just outlined, but if you then added over the overlay beyond the CEF data and the clearing data and looked at non-Euro, we find at LCH that the EU firms, by origin, by LEI, they're trading and clearing more non-Euro than in total than they are of Euro as well. So it's kind of very polarized on the Euro debate. I think when we're talking about access to UK CCPs, it's for everything, it's not just for Euro. So it's an important data point. But I think the headline is, when I look at this, it's an international currency. The euro is an international currency. It's very pervasive, but it's used by, three quarters of the trades are done by people who aren't in the EU. So it's a real good story for the EU and the euro as a reserve currency. So now the EU firms have access to global liquidity, better pricing, better risk management and all the other benefits that go with that. I think if you look at the opposite of this, if we go down the route of some form of restriction or denial of access or denial of recognition, you end up with no choice. You end up with no competition, potentially in CCPs. You end up with poor access to liquidity. One would argue poor access to execution pricing, more risk in the system and more cost. So I think for me, forcibly fragmenting liquidity is really going to increase the financial stability risk rather than reducing it. So we think the debate needs to really move on, and it is doing, to focus on how can the EU authorities have a say in the global markets and have a seat at the table and how they're run. And, you know, to start off with, EMEA 2.2 was designed with this specifically in mind for UK CCPs. LCH Limited, we operate across 60 jurisdictions. We are licensed by 11 countries, pretty much all of the G20, with direct supervision of various sorts. We're subject to the EU and EMEA requirements. They have direct supervision by ESMA. All this has happened since the beginning of 2020. So we have direct application of EMEA 2.2, direct oversight of ESMA. We have a direct account at the ECB for all of our euros as well. These are all developments that have happened since the day of Brexit. So what you can really see is there's a lot of oversight, and the tools and the mitigants that, you know, to offset the concerns are there in place today. So for us, what this is about finding a way where global markets and global CCPs can operate with global regulation and global cooperation supervision.
Thanks, Dan. Thank you. Thanks. Phil, could you respond to that and cover the same two topics, please?
Yeah, I mean, the data is the data. You can't argue with that. But as an ex trader, the key issue for me is about the trends. And, you know, we always used to say the trend is your friend. And so if we actually look at the trends in those statistics, if I look at, for example, the overall ADV that we now have in interest rate derivatives, which is at 144 billion per day, that's up 17.4% on January the 1st this year. Notional outstanding, which we also look at, is now at 21 trillion, which is up 20.9% since the beginning of this year. If you break it down and just look at the long-dated IRS, which I think your stats were, that's 21 billion a day, which is up 7%, and it's 10.3 trillion in notional outstanding, which is up 17.8% since January the 1st. So, I mean, I think those are kind of key trends that demonstrate, you know, what European end clients specifically are doing. And an important stat that you don't have, but we do have, is on the DVO1. And the DVO1 really represents, you know, how much risk is being transferred to the CCP. And since January the 1st this year, the DVO1 has increased on the end client DVO1 has increased by 160 million, which is up 44% since January. The DVO1 of the dealer banks has stayed pretty well flat. And a lot of this is being driven, you know, by CCP switch activity. We've done 2.3 trillion amongst 20 participants who've actually chose to move that risk over. And I think there was a very good article recently by Aegon, and they talked about their experiences on that, and others such as BMO GAM have talked about it historically. But it demonstrates that it's feasible. It demonstrates that we have a very strong liquidity pool. You get pretty well the same bid offer spreads with us as you do at the other CCPs. But I think as well, if you look at kind of history and the trends, what else has happened in the market, you know, since Brexit. If we look at the euro repo market, you know, that's moved pretty well in its entirety now to the EU with no real disruption. If I look at the ETD market, we used to effectively, from a trading perspective first, then a clearing perspective, from a trading perspective, pre-Brexit, 61% of the traded volume in our euro-denominated products came from UK counterparties. It was 61%. That's now 30%. And from the EU, it used to be 12%, and it's now 80% originates from Europe. So those are the trends. If I look at it from a clearing perspective, it was 55% from the UK, and it's now 34%, and it was 40% from the EU, and it's now 61%. So I think, you know, those are the clear trends for me. So it's not a question of if liquidity moves, it's a question of by how much and when.
And, right? And have we got 30 seconds on the point on financial stability, Phil, just to...
Yeah, I think, you know, the EMEA 2.2 kind of lays out, you know, how it wants to assess systemic risk. And I think that Natasha kind of brought that up earlier, and I can't really say kind of much more than she said on that, but it sets out the stall by which ESMA and the ECB and the Commission is looking at that financial stability risk. I think, you know, it's about the dependency on third countries is where the financial stability risk comes. And if you look specifically at what's happened over the pandemic and under, you know, what's coming under climate change, it's very important that the EU develops its own primary market. And for that, you need a very good and strong secondary market. And that's what, you know, the review of MiFID II and EMIR is all about. And I think, you know, quite rightly so, you look at America under Trump, Biden hasn't changed his stance on that. It's America first. You listen to Boris on Brexit, and it's all about, you know, what's best for the UK economy and the UK businesses. It's natural that the EU also wants to look at it in a similar way as everybody else.
Thank you. So turning to the view from the buy side and the sell side and the implications of any regulatory mandate, you know, Walt referenced it in his opening remarks today that, you know, the FIA and 9 other trade associations have written a letter on the 16th of September to Commissioner McGuinness calling for an extension of the time limited equivalence and also asking for clarity as soon as possible, because there is a lot of uncertainty as we build up to the June deadline next year. The FIA members and are fully supportive of open market access. Any shift of euro liquidity should be on a voluntary basis and not market driven, and it should be organic growth over time. So, Bill, turning to yourself, representing a European domiciled clearing firm, you know, what are some of the potential consequences of any regulatory mandate or location policy for EU clearing firms?
Thanks, Bruce. I thought I'd just take 1 minute to go through the process, just to remind people of how it works in the EU. So you have the process starts with the Commission, and it assesses whether the regulation CCP framework of a given jurisdiction is equivalent to that in the UK, sorry, in the EU. Assuming equivalence is then granted, then ESMA assesses each CCP one by one and recognises each CCP on a one by one basis. So it's a two-step process. You have to have a jurisdictional equivalence and then CCP recognition. The impact of not being recognised on a CCP if you're an EU firm is threefold. It seems to be pretty clear that EU firms wouldn't be able to maintain membership of a non-recognised CCP. That's not entirely certain, but we think that's the most likely interpretation of the way the rules are written. So EU membership becomes difficult. Non-recognised CCPs are treated as non-qualifying, which gives you a significant capital hit. So we estimate something between 50 to 100 times the capital for holding the same positions at a non-recognised CCP or non-qualifying CCP. So it's not just a bit of an uptick. It's not the sort of capital cost you can take into your business. And even if you're able to work around those, the third issue is that for the OTC derivatives, you can't fulfill your clearing obligation at a non-qualifying or non-recognised CCP. So that has some fairly significant impacts if you're an EU firm, and it sort of kits in four scenarios. You have your house and your client business, and then OTC and exchange traded. Bruce, I was going to sort of merge two sets of comments together just with time there. So on the client side of things, first of all, given the capital requirements, it becomes very difficult to offer a full clearing service to all of your clients, particularly those looking for global coverage. The non-recognised CCPs, certainly for clients with any sort of significant position, become very expensive to maintain those positions on your balance sheet. Furthermore, what we also see is that there's plenty of products available in the UK that are not available in the EU. There's no equivalent product, and as we've seen many times, it's already come up this morning, and obviously with the news on Curve Global from last week, it's quite difficult to build liquidity in new products. In fact, nigh on impossible. You know, it's much more complicated than just listing a contract on a venue, adding it to a CCP, and watching the volumes turn up. So a lot of products are not available in the EU that are available in the UK. But that's probably not from an EU perspective or EU clearing broker perspective, that's probably not the biggest issue on the exchange traders side. The issue here is that actually non-recognition has very limited legislative impact on our clients. That outside of OTC derivatives, these clients can continue to access UK CCPs just through a non-EU broker. So in essence, we would expect them to continue to do that. And find alternative broking solutions. On the house side, of course, we can't access them directly as a member, so we would need to become a client of a local carry broker. And for the large European banks, I don't necessarily see my colleagues bending over backwards to offer their balance sheet to firms that compete with them in those markets. So there's definitely quite a big market structure issue around that, and the fact that actually clients will likely change brokers away from EU brokers. On the OTC side, as Dan mentioned just very briefly, 75% of euro volumes are traded outside the EU. So if you're restricted to a pool of 25% of the volumes, that has inevitable impacts on your OTC house business. So quite complicated. And the other issue about legacy portfolio and leaving it where it is or moving it, it's a complicated topic, which we could spend all day on. But I would just say it's a lot easier said than done.
Thanks, Bill. And Nafisa, turning to you to get a view from the buy side and the impacts of any regulatory mandate, and also maybe you could cover, you know, what are some of the key drivers for clients on when they make the decision of where to clear?
Sure, thanks. So firstly, we act as fiduciary on behalf of our clients, and we are agnostic to the location of the CCP. So we're really looking at the portfolios that we're managing on behalf of our clients. We're looking at the products, the currencies, and really the factors that go into electing a CCP sort of revolve around client preference, the liquidity in the asset classes and the currencies. We're looking at trading efficiencies, for example, through block trading, and then also the margin efficiencies that you get through netting. So it's not a one size fits all. Obviously, being a global investment manager, we are managing quite a global, diverse book of clients. So for some clients, you know, netting across currencies is going to be more cost efficient. And then for other clients, it might be product cross-product margining. So it really does depend. But having the choice of alternate CCPs is sort of the best outcome for our end clients because it does give them the best the best opportunities to meet their portfolio needs. A forced location would hinder a lot of what makes clearing compelling today. So from a best execution perspective, you know, a split liquidity pool will have negative impacts to that. From a portfolio management perspective, you're having to manage a split book across multiple CCPs, removing netting efficiencies. And then the last point I'd make is many of our Euro clients also clear in voluntary currencies, which, you know, can't be accessed at all CCPs. So having to access multiple CCPs could increase costs for them.
Thank you. And turning to you, Emma, I mean, to get the view from an international clear with foot in both camps, just to give, you know, your view on the potential consequences, but also, you know, if there is a mandate, you know, what are some of the challenges for clients who would have to, you know, close their positions on one CCP and reopen them on another?
Yeah, thanks, Bruce. So as an international player, I think, you know, the immediate impact is probably less in the sense that we provide access to global CCPs. So, you know, most you know, international providers are set up for that. So low impact day one. I think in terms of short-term market disruption, that's where you see, you know, potentially some challenges with regards to closing positions out. There's no transferability. So, you know, having to close positions on one CCP and move them, reopen them on another is obviously going to cause some sort of market disruption from that perspective if there is a forced sort of situation. I think, you know, as Bill said, the local players are probably going to be more impacted when they're restricted by venue, that we see that. So depending on what clients are doing and, you know, where they're having to go through, that might be an issue. I think the other thing for us to consider is, you know, managing the risk in two places now. That's obviously something that we've got to think through. Other impacts of that are going to be, you know, differences to the default fund contributions and capital requirements in one versus the other legal entity. And I think, you know, from a practical perspective, the legal and operational setup is something that has to be thought through. I think most clients are getting themselves ready for that change, but that's the initial element. Then obviously there's the move of the positions. We talked a little bit about product set and offering. That's something to think through. Look at your books in terms of what you're getting at the existing venue versus the other. And then, of course, with any fragmentation, you get inefficiencies. So, you know, that as I walk through both operational and margin inefficiencies potentially there as well.
Thanks, Emma. I think we started late, so I think we've got another 10, 15 minutes, so someone can come and get me if I run over. But I wanted to turn to, you know, the regulatory divergence, because I think it is interesting in its own right with the reviews that are going on, or the MiFID review that's happened in the EU and is continuing, and the wholesale markets review and the other multiple consultations that are going on reviewing the regulatory regime in the UK. And that is also important from an equivalence perspective. Commissioner McGuinness said recently that the UK desire to part from EU rules for financial markets means that future equivalence agreements will come with timeframes and need to be in the interests of the EU. So Dan, you know, turning to yourself, are you concerned about the potential regulatory deviation that's happening between the UK and the EU? And really, in the context of equivalence, are you concerned that it will have an impact on equivalence not being extended next year?
Conscious of time, I'm going to be slightly cheeky and just go back. I want to challenge Phil a little bit on something. I'll come straight to your point. Ahon also said in the article that they want access to UK CCPs and liquidity. So it wasn't just about moving things. And the repo transition was market driven because it made economic sense. So I don't think we should use that as an example of things. Anyway, to your question. Sorry, I had to say that. It wouldn't be a panel if we didn't disagree. I think it's a myth is the reality in terms of this regulatory divergence in the context of clearing. There's zero indication from the UK of any direction to lower CCP standards. And living and breathing every day, all I can tell you is they go higher and higher every single day. And in fact, we're seeing the opposite. We saw the Chancellor, Rishi Sunak, I think it was July this year, at Mansion House, state very publicly that CCPs will be held to the highest standards. There's no appetite for divergence or reducing of standards. So I think it's personally a bit of a myth. There are good examples of that, but given time, I'll not bore you with it. What I'd also say is customers, dealers, clearing members all expect the highest standards of the CCPs as well. So even if the regulators somehow decided that they would reduce the standards, the customers, and given that we're overseen by EU law, by EMEA, subject to the European Court of Justice as well, if we want to operate as a CCP in the EU for EU firms, we have to operate to those standards as a minimum. So I think it's all a bit of a myth, and really what you do is CCPs like ours, it's actually a competitive advantage to operate to the highest standards. So regardless of what's going on around us, we'll look around the globe, what's the minimum that we have to do to comply with all the regulation? Sorry, the maximum we have to do, and we'll make that our minimum. We're always going to operate higher than the standards that we're subject to, whichever jurisdiction we're in, because we live by the rule that nobody really wants a CCP. So I'll leave it at that. I'll pause there.
Thanks. And Phil, Dan says it's a myth. I mean, do you think that the deviation is material enough to be a concern to the industry or with regard to equivalence?
I definitely don't think it's a myth because, I mean, you already heard it from Natasha in the keynote that there is already appearing some regulatory divergence. And I think the UK has clearly stated that they're reviewing the regulations as a result of Brexit and they expect that there will be some divergence in other areas. But I think there are some important areas where it could and is starting to diverge, right? So if you look, for example, the EU or the UK left the EU before the implementation of the recovery and resolution regulations, into law. The UK hasn't yet transposed them into UK law. And there are certain elements within those regulations that are really quite important. You know, second skin in the game being one, compensation on no creditor worse off, being another. And so we can already see within some of the Bank of England proposals and within the various CCP rule books that, things are starting to be tweaked in terms of default processes, risk management procedures, etc. So I think what we know is that there will be divergence. It's not a question of if there will. It's inevitable. There will be. But it comes back to your question: is by how much will it diverge, and what is the impact of that divergence from an EU perspective on the financial stability of clients or counterparties within the EU, and on the stability of the euro, and how does that all fit in with their capital markets union plans, etc. So I think it's not as simple as just will it or will it not diverge. Yes, it will. By how much? We can't say by how much. We don't know what the future looks like in that regard. Is there a real risk around non-equivalence or some kind of restricted equivalence? I think there is a genuine risk of that, and I think the clearing members are prepared for that. I think that is prudent. I think end clients, and we strongly encourage end clients to open an account with us and to get active. That is prudent risk management in something that I think is where divergence is inevitable.
Thank you, Phil. And Nafisa, turning to you, end clients, Phil mentioned end clients. I mean, can you give us your view on the general view on regulatory deviation, and is it a concern, and what are the practical implications for BlackRock and other asset management clients?
So again, we're looking at this very much as the voice is for the end client. So supportive of the CMU for our Euro clients and also the UK capital markets regulation for our UK clients. I guess deviation is a natural consequence of Brexit. We'd probably see something, but the challenge really and the concern for I think any global firm that operates in both regions is the misalignment and the inconsistencies that it then causes. So we've all over the years we've built up our infrastructure, we've built up our connectivity to support regulation, and then sort of having forms of deviation only leads to obviously ambiguity, but then also incurred costs as we look to build to ensure that we're always adhering to the different regulations. So I sort of keeping clearing aside, I actually don't think clearing is necessarily always the key factor in deviation. There's other areas, for example, if we look at that UK wholesale markets review, transparency in the fixed income and derivatives products could potentially be more meaningful when it comes to reducing cost and complexity.
Thank you. And Emma, turning to you, you've already got, as I said earlier, a foot in both camps. You spent a lot of time building up to Brexit on implementing your, you know, building out your European model. You know, what are some of the consequences? Are there opportunities? What are the risks for international clearing firms due to the ongoing reviews and potential deviation of regulation?
I won't get into the politics of it. Obviously, we know Brexit is Brexit, and look, there's obviously potentially some opportunities for the UK to look at specific areas of regulation that maybe weren't suited to the UK. But there is definitely a balance to be struck there in terms of having looking at equivalence and maintaining those standards as discussed earlier. I think for a firm like us, we're used to dealing with change and adapting to that. It does make it more onerous and expensive. But we've been through it multiple times for various reasons, MiFID or Brexit, et cetera. So, we'll have to go with that. But I do think that, we need to somehow find that balance as well to continue. I think, obviously, for any clearer, equivalence is the best route. It requires less change and less resource to adapt. But obviously, if it happens, that's what we'll do.
Thank you. And Bill, from an EU clearing perspective, is this seen as a fine-tuning of regulations by the EU and the UK, or is this a race to the bottom for regulation? And are you concerned, going back to the start of the conversation about equivalence, with the implications that any divergence would have?
Yeah, it's an interesting one. I think I don't have a lot to add, but my first observation on the wholesale markets review is it's very much about, it's not about tearing things up and starting again. It's about how do we make the current framework of MTF, OTF, and reporting, etc., work in the for the EU. It's not about tearing it up. It's not about starting again. It's not about a race to the bottom. It's quite clearly not that. So the deviations will come, but based on the same on the same foundations. There are much bigger deviations with other jurisdictions that are considered to be equivalent. Now we can talk about the distance offshore, etc., but fundamentally, if you look at how trading and clearing works, say in the US, it's hugely different in terms of its underpinnings in legislation. The UK will be much more similar to the EU than that. Having said that, there are some differences. Whether they prove to be important or not is proving very difficult to predict. I think we should probably leave it there.
Okay, thanks. And look, let's finish. Kirst, we started with you. We're going to finish with you. We heard from Natasha Kazanev that the reviews are going on with a focus on, I think she said, reducing complexity. That is certainly the stated aim from the UK regulators, to reduce cost and complexity and increase competition. That's the whole stated aim of the wholesale markets review. So are the reviews an opportunity to reduce costs and increase competition, or will the regulatory deviation add additional complexity?
There's definitely the opportunity. I mean, I think the first thing is it's only fit and proper that regulators globally, not just the UK and the EU, continue to review all regulations to make sure that they're necessary, sufficient, well calibrated to the markets they're trying to regulate, not a regulation that doesn't quite fit that market. So I think, I'm certain that the EU and the UK, and we've seen lots of stuff already, will continue to review TOTV, DTO, clearing obligation, transparency, identifiers. There's loads of stuff out there that they're reviewing. And I think it is more of a calibration. As Bill said, I don't think it's a tear up and start again. I think it is about calibration. But I think what we all want, and I think everyone on the panel wants, is well-regulated global markets with competition at every layer of the ecosystem. And if we end up with that and less complexity, it will reduce cost and risk. And ultimately, I think that's in everyone's interest. So I guess we'll leave it there.
Thank you for the summary. We're going to have to leave it there, I'm afraid. We're running out of time. I'd like to say a big thank you to my panel, Dan, Nafisa, Bill, Emma, Phil, and Kirston. It's been a pleasure. I thank you for the excellent contributions. We're now going to move to a networking break. I think we're due back at 10 past 12, and we'll be listening to our second keynote of the day, Richard Knox from Her Majesty's Treasury. I hope you've enjoyed the panel. Thank you very much.